All right, so I'm just gonna run through a little bit more, and then I'm gonna call it a clown. And then we're gonna talk about one sort of real life issue that has to do with this, and then we'll call it a day. So, may end up taking an hour and 10 minutes. We'll see. So just shooting through the rest of these issues. These are really the six main issues. James Rachels, specifically, he's the other reading you're going to do, right? So you've got, for the homework this week, the reading Ruth Benedict and her defense of moral or ethical relativism, and then James Rachels famously responds to that and gives a pretty strong argument for why he doesn't think that relativism is a good thing. And so we're kind of just going through some of his points. He doesn't make all of these, but some of the arguments against relativism. Professor actual morality, that was the thing I was supposed to talk about, is the distinction between people's beliefs and their actions. Right? Do they say they believe a thing, but they act in another way? Which is the one that we're supposed to think is right? That's not always clear. Right? Certainly there are people in this culture, in this country, who say they believe one thing, but then they act in a totally different way. And so how do we know which one is the right one, and the one that we're supposed to say is the appropriate rule for this culture? It's really challenging. What is a majority? Specifically, can a majority change? Right? In the sense of, for example, legalization of marijuana is a pretty good example. You know, 30 years ago, the vast majority of people in this country were strongly opposed to the legalization of marijuana. Like, whoa, hey, that's a crazy drug, it's the devil's weed, it'll make you nuts, right? And now there's a pretty significant shift in the other direction. And there are states that are legalizing it all over the country, and if I had to guess, I'd say in another 30 years, it'll be legal throughout the country. And so at what point, right, when does that become culturally, when did it become right? At what point did smoking marijuana go from being wrong to right in this culture? It's interesting. So what do you mean by that, just to follow up on that? Government doesn't, government doesn't make as much money as pharmaceutical companies, right? Not even close. Even if they tax it, right, they won't make nearly as much money as other people do, which is kind of the point. Like, nobody would sell it if they weren't making as much. If they're giving more money to the government than they are making themselves. So cynical Crystal, I'll respond to you with maybe a better example, which would be gay marriage. Not a lot of people making money. I guess churches and marriage, wedding companies are technically making more money this way than they would have otherwise, but I don't think that's a big cash cow, right? But certainly that has become, regardless of, individual feelings in this room about gay marriage, certainly the opinion culturally has made a significant shift in a relatively short period of time from, whoa, that's no good, to, let them get married, why not?
I kind of feel like that also has something to do with the generational shift, as younger people are getting older, our norms are different than that of, like, my grandmother, her mother.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm not going to say there was probably just as many, but it wasn't looked at as being okay. So they could have felt that way and just not said something.
Yeah, but probably most people didn't feel that way, right? I mean, there may have been some who were, like, really progressive and, like, feeling, it should be all right, but most people don't agree with me, so I'm going to keep my mouth shut. But probably most people didn't feel that way. And honestly, I'm not really concerned so much about what caused the shift. I think you're right, in terms of, generally, culture becoming more progressive and liberal and sort of more open to things than it was before. But the question is, when, like, there's got to be one moment when it went from being not okay to okay. And what was that moment? Could we identify? Could we find that second when it suddenly, the switch flipped and it went okay? And could it go the other way? Could it go back? right? Could. It's not impossible to imagine.
And so what is really the cultural norm here? Is there one?
If we can go back and forth, if we can change, if majorities can go, you know, can fluctuate, then are we really, do we really even have a cultural norm? It seems like we do, but it's, if are we talking about there's a is time a big deal here? Is the cultural norm of the United States in 1975 one thing, right? And the cultural norm of the United States in 2017 another thing, and then they can't really even compare between the two, which is what you get all the time. And you're like, oh yeah, you know, you can't give my racist grandma a hard time. She's just from, you know, she's old. She's from a different time.
Well,
that's basically what you're saying, is that was a different culture that can't be judged from today's standards because it goes not just in space, but also in time. Because it changes. And if it changes, if things can change, then it seems really hard to establish, like, when does it change and how does it change? Is it simply a matter of, you know, young, progressive, fun people growing up and, you know, old, boring fuddy-duddies wandering off into the woods and getting eaten by that bear? One can hope.
What is a culture at all? Right, we're talking about culture and like the norms of culture, but what is a culture? Right,
every single person in this room is a member of probably five or six different sort of groups, social groups, cultural groups. Is culture based on geography, which it kind of used to be back before travel became much, much easier? Is it based on geography? Is it based on ethnic heritage? Is it based on cultural heritage, like where you live now in terms of, you know, just the sort of population, rural versus urban, your religion? What is it that makes a culture? Can you be subject to multiple different norms at the same time? And what if those norms are in conflict? Which I see a lot when we talk about culture, like religion, and like the cultural, social cultural things. And again, when we talk about gay marriage, is a great example. A lot of people feel the conflict of, I'm a Christian and the Bible says no, but I'm an American and we're kind of okay with that. And so how do I decide which one is the right one to follow in any given moment when they come into conflict? It's really hard to know what is your culture. We all belong to lots of different cultures. And finally, and this is sort of this is my favorite response, because this is the one that relies entirely on like logic. Can tolerance be a universal value? What do I mean by universal? Was that just worldwide? Sure, applied to everybody. The whole idea behind ethical relativism, and I'm pointing back a little up a bit, the whole idea of ethical relativism is that whatever is normal is what is good. And so each culture has to be tolerant of another. You cannot have moral opinions about other cultures. And so basically what relativism is saying is that being tolerant is a virtue, is a value that everyone should practice. Right? Being tolerant of other cultures is something that we should all do. Does anybody see a problem with those statements? Patrick?
North Korea.
I wasn't aiming at a specific, like, I wasn't thinking about a specific example, like an inductive sort of thing. I was thinking more of like a logical problem with saying those two sentences at the same time.
Okay, so how could it be universal? Because how would we agree? We're not agreeing. And essentially, we're saying if I'm going to be tolerant, that I can never agree or disagree with you.
Right.
I'm just going to stay in my lane, and wherever your lane takes you, it takes you.
Yes.
And you'll never know if I can bring you to a better or worse. worse, you know, I can't sway you either way.
And so, that's relativism. And so you're saying, and part of that is, I should be tolerant of all of those other groups. But what's the problem with saying that? Like, you've described relativism beautifully. But what's the problem with saying that I'm going to tolerate everyone else's version of that?
Because everybody's not going to tolerate mine.
Because
not necessarily. But, Christine, Tayshaun, somebody.
That's exactly what I was trying to say. Because everyone is not going to tolerate mine. So at what point do I...
Let's say I could say, hey guys, ethical relativism, I'm in charge, I'm president of the planet, and I'm like, ethical relativism is the way to go, we should all tolerate each other. Why? Not just unrealistic, it's impossible. Why?
Because of human behavior.
Because everybody has their own.
Logically, why? Think about the words. I'm saying, I am president of the planet, and I'm saying, hey everybody, you all have to agree that there are no rules that will apply to everybody.
Then you disagreed.
You disagreed.
Then there's a rule called tolerance.
Yes, exactly. There's except for this one rule, right? There are no rules that will apply to everybody except for this one rule that says that there are no rules that will apply to everybody, right?
Does that?
Gone in circles. Yeah. The whole idea,
because he just made a rule,
is that tolerance is a virtue, right? That by tolerance, what I mean is that everyone's allowed to have their own rules. There are no universals, right? Everything is subjective and individual and depends upon the particular culture, right? There is no, imagine, I can kind of do this visually again. Here's group A, here's group B, here's group C. There is no group D that they are all members of. That each group has its own set of rules and under expectations. And you know, in group A, they wear shoes all the time. In group B, they hate shoes. And that's just as good as group A, right? We can't say, well, group A is normal and group B is weird. We have to say, normal, totally okay, both of them. And group C wears fish on their feet. Right? Like they cut open dead fish and they put their feet in them and they walk around in those. And we have to agree, like that's cool too. Because that's just what they do in group C. And we're not, and we are all about tolerance and about understanding and not judging. So, if there are no universal rules, I can't come in and say, hey guys, I have a universal rule for you. And that universal rule is there are no universal rules. It's logically impossible.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense. You're requiring, by establishing ethical relativism as like the way we work, you're establishing that as the universal rule. Ethical relativism is right and everything else is wrong. Well, what if I don't believe in ethical relativism? I don't know what to say to you, right? You're wrong for not believing in ethical relativism, but you're right for having your own opinion, right? Like, there's no way to make that mesh. Ethical relativism is literally, logically impossible. Right? Even though we want it to be good, right? We want to believe in it. We want to say, yeah, it's cool, guys, that you do things your way, that you wear the fish on your feet. Like, doesn't bother me, shouldn't bother anybody, go for it. And it is okay when it's something as silly as wearing fish on your feet, right? It doesn't bother anybody. I mean, maybe it smells, but it doesn't hurt anybody. Go nuts. But when things do hurt somebody, when you've got a crazy guy with nuclear weapons who just dying to shoot him with somebody, like, it's okay to have a feeling about, a judgment about that, right? It seems to be that tolerance doesn't have to be a universal value. We don't have to tolerate everything in all things. It's okay to say, nope, that thing's not all right. It's not okay. And I looked it up. I knew there was a word for it. I couldn't remember it off the top of my head. Tsuchigiri literally means crossroads killing. That was the word for the samurai guy walking down the road and just being like, hey, you, right? We're allowed to say, no, that's not cool. Can't just walk around killing peasants or whomever you mean, right? It's okay, and
I don't want to cause any fights at Thanksgiving or anything like that, but it's okay to say, no, racist grandma's not cool, right? You're not allowed to feel that way. Even though you were brought up a different time, I'm allowed to think that that's wrong, right? You don't have to tolerate everything. There are things that are unacceptable no matter what culture you're in or what culture I'm in. This idea that there are rules that will apply to everybody is usually called universalism, as it is sort of the opposite of relativism. So relativism is the idea that everything is relative, everything is dependent upon your own sort of experience and your culture and so on. Universalism is the idea that there are universal laws or rules that will apply to everybody, regardless of culture or upbringing or class or race or whatever. I don't like the word race. Sorry. Every once in a while it pops out. I don't like it. I try not to use it. I feel like it's an artificial construct. We're all human beings. Yeah. But it applies to everybody, right? These universal rules. And there are different versions of universalism, different sort of like degrees of it. Hard universalism is the sort of most extreme version of universalism, which is the idea that there is a set of rules that applies to everyone. We might not know them yet, right? We might not have been able to kind of figure out the rules. But give us enough time and enough philosophy classes and enough philosophy students, we'll get there, right? We will figure out what the rules are that apply to everybody. We're still working on it, but eventually we'll figure, just like eventually we'll figure out what quarks are made of and where the universe came from and so on, right? We don't know yet, but we'll get there. And the same idea is for universalists, that we don't yet know all the rules, but they exist and we'll get there. And we can kind of prove it based on like our feelings about the cutting down, the tsuchigiri and all the other things that we've talked about, right? These sort of ethical, these points where you're like, that doesn't feel right. Right? You can acknowledge that's a wrong thing. A soft universalist agrees that there are rules that will apply to everybody, but they are sort of more just sort of basic things that we all want to have in our cultures. For example, the soft universalist is going to look at the Eskimo family that throws the baby out into the cold unless it dies. And he's going to note that, well, they don't do that just for fun, or just because they don't like girl babies. They do that because there are far more girls in their culture than there are boys, and the men are the ones who, in the hunting society, all of their food comes from meat. The men do the hunting. If there are too many women and not enough men, they won't be able to have enough food, they won't have enough food, and people will starve. And the people who will starve will be little children. So what you're doing is you're sacrificing one newborn for the lives of the other children in your family. Now that's horrible. But we can acknowledge that what's really going on there is a common belief in, you know, protecting as many people as possible, right? Saving as many. Sometimes we sacrifice for the greater good. Right? There's a rule there, and I'm not sure if I could put it exactly into words, but there's a rule there that we can sort of grasp and say, okay, I see now that we do have a common understanding somewhere. There's a common agreement. Like, we don't agree that throwing babies out in the snow is a good idea, but we do agree that saving as many people as possible is a good thing. Right? So a soft universalist is going to say, there may not be like hard and fast, codified, like never ever throw a baby out into the snow rules, but there are basic fundamental rules that every society wants and maybe needs in order to be successful. Our friend Rachel's, who's down here, right? He believes there are three rules. I think it's more complicated than that, but he believes in three. The first one is protecting and growing as many children as you can. Right? Every society needs that, right? A rule that protects and supports as many living children as possible. Two, no killing each other. And three,
no lying. That every culture is going to have those three base ideas built into them. And we can spend a lot of time talking about how persuasive Rachel's is there. I mean, like the baby thing, the child thing, is that really a cultural, is that an ethical rule, or is that really just like a necessary thing to have society, right? Obviously you have to have children in order for society to exist. So is that an ethical belief, or is it just necessary? Like everybody has to eat, right? That's not an ethical statement, that's just necessary. So maybe the kid thing, right? So we could get into a lot of discussion here. Lying is a great example, right? Everybody lies. Sometimes people lie for good reasons, right? For not hurting people's feelings, maybe what he means is no malicious lying, right? Because that leads to a breakdown in communication. If you can't trust anybody, then you can't communicate at all, and so society falls apart. Same thing with murder, right? If you can't believe that you can walk out of your door without being just sort of randomly killed, then the society is not going to survive. And in fact, right, in historical times, that's kind of how society starts. Bands of people who all agree that we're not going to kill each other, whether they were family or, you know, the small groups that eventually became much larger groups. It started with the idea of like, okay, we 10 people, we all promise we're not going to kill each other. It's basically the beginning of every like Walking Dead episode, right? Like, we're not, the three of us aren't going to kill each other, right? And then it goes from there, right? That's kind of how society goes. And that's the only thing that makes Walking Dead interesting, is this is a really interesting little view of how society goes. Again, I'm not sure Rachel's has absolutely got it. He's on, I think there's an interesting path that he's on. I think he's headed in a good direction. I certainly am not a fan of relativism. I think universalism has a much better shot going on, although I'm not trying to tell you what you should think. Although we're gonna get to that in a second. But I don't know that anybody's actually, clearly nobody's come up with the hard universalist explanation yet of what ethics is. But that's basically what we're doing for the rest of this class. We are addressing ways that people, we're gonna talk about theories that people have come up with in order to establish this hard universalist approach, right? People, very, very smart people, over time have come up with, I know, here's a way we can establish what is right and wrong that will work every time for every person in every society, no matter what. And we're gonna talk about a variety of those answers that people have come up with, and then we're gonna point out why they're wrong. Because if somebody had actually solved it, we'd know, right? If somebody had cracked the code, we'd know. And so nobody has yet come up with a perfect answer, but people have approached it from a variety of different ways, and that's really interesting and can be educational to see the ways that people have thought about how to determine what's right and wrong. And that is what we will be doing for the last 6 weeks of the course, now that I've kind of gotten these two things out of the way. Why do I need to get these two? Are there any questions? Questions about sort of the... being a little dramatic here, and maybe you don't agree with me. It's okay if you still think that relativism is a way to approach things. That's not the end of the world. It won't cause me any, it won't keep me up at night, although there is going to be a caveat to that in a minute. It's okay if you feel that way, but I like to think of that as basically the death of relativism and the explanation of universalism. Does everybody kind of get what those things are? Are there any questions about that? You're not as clear on soft as you are on hard. Imagine hard universalism as like the book that you get when you're learning how to drive. Hard universalism is a whole set of rules that apply. Soft universalism is like when your mom or dad sits down in the car with you and says, "So the goal is get there in one piece and don't ruin the transmission," right? These are just like, there are some basic underlying ideas that we are willing to grasp that probably apply to everybody, but we don't know what the full set of commandments is, right? Whereas hard universalism is saying, there exists a
law, set of laws that we haven't figured out entirely, but they're out there somewhere. And just so we're clear, this does not necessarily mean that there's like a religious explanation, right? Just like in the sense of they're out there somewhere, doesn't mean like we haven't figured out what God's plan is, right? That could be one way of looking at it, right? And I'm not saying that that's impossible, but it doesn't require religion. Like, we don't have to assume that someone wrote the rules and we just haven't figured them out yet. There may be a biological, psychological set of rules that are just tied into being human being, as Christine said, wired into our DNA in the last year, that we just haven't yet unraveled correctly, using, you know, science, which can tell us all sorts of things, unless you're Republican, in which case. I should stop doing stuff like that. I don't mean to bash anybody. I do mean to bash. What's the point? Two things I wanted to point out real quick. And I was kind of talking to Patrick about this during the break, but I want to make sure everybody is clear. We have the talk here at the beginning of this class about religion and about relativism, because they are two pitfalls that are very, very common issues for folks who are new to ethics, to this discussion. The first problem is almost always like, right and wrong, well, the Bible tells me, or the commandments tell me, or the Quran tells me, so I don't have to think any further about that. And that's just not gonna help us. That's not gonna do it for this class, as I think I've made pretty clear. Right? We need to go beyond the religious answer. The second most common problem is, well, I don't agree, but hey, you know, that's just the way they do it. And that won't work for this class either. Maybe in real life, you're in a position where you have to, like, just agree to disagree, you know, and I'm not gonna give you a hard time for what you think and so on. And that's great. It's very nice of you all to do that if that's what you do. It's not what I do. In fact, my wife and I don't agree to disagree about anything. I don't even say those. We don't say those words. I hate those words, agree to disagree. No one in the world has ever done that. But that's okay if you do that. But in this class, we're not going to agree to disagree or say, well, you know, your opinion's valid. Right? No, we're going to have the argument, right? Because that's the point. We're going to talk it out. We're going to discuss. We're going to see, make sure we understand the benefits and the merits of each person's argument, and ideally come to an agreement. That's kind of the goal. We won't always, mostly because of time. You know, we don't have an infinite amount of it, so we won't necessarily always come to an agreement. But what we're not going to do is just say, well, I'm not even going to talk about it because I don't want to insult anybody, or I don't want to disagree because I'm not confrontational, or I'm just going to say, like, I don't know what the right answer is, but I don't care because it's up to them. We're going to think about these things. We're going to work our way through. And so what I don't ever want to see on a paper or on a writing assignment is, well, you know, that's just their opinion. Or even, it's just my opinion, right? If you think something, you need to tell me why you think it. Yeah?
Can we invite people to class?
Absolutely. Is there a racist grandma coming?
No.
No. All right. Because that would be awesome. I don't regret not having a chance to argue with my racist grandma before she died. Like, she died and sad, whatever. But I really wish that I had been older so that I could have been like,
what? No,
it's just one of those things. I really wish I had a chance to beat my grandmother with like logic and reason rather than just whatever. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. Questions? Thoughts? Okay. So, I'm not letting you go yet. Don't pack up. As I kind of mentioned last time, I think it's really valuable to talk about a sort of a current issue in relation to the thing that we've just discussed. And we've had lots of examples today, but there's sort of the classic relativism issue. And maybe some of you guys have heard about this and studied about it, maybe not. It's not on the front pages like it really should be. But it's a pretty good example of some of the issues here that we see.
one of the big relativist and sort of universal issues right now, and maybe some of you have heard of this, is a female circumcision.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the right face, right? And I think that it's not hopefully going to be super controversial in this room, but this is a controversial thing, right? There's female circumcision, which isn't really even circumcision. It's really more accurately female genital mutilation, right? And it's a common occurrence in countries around the world, in various religions. It's not really a religious thing. It's more of a cultural thing in a bunch of different countries, in lots of different places. That involves surgically removing parts of women's genitalia for lots of reasons. A lot of it has to do with just sort of, some of it's just custom, it's just the way they've always done it. Some of it's supposed to be about health or cleanliness or cultural issues around the idea that women aren't supposed to enjoy sex. There are all sorts of these arguments about why it happens. And there's a temptation to think it's in these sort of, you know, backwards, primitive places around the world, but it happens here in the United States quite a bit. Not quite a bit's a relative word, but more often than probably people imagine. And the defense is almost always, that's just that person's culture. That is the way that those people have existed, right? Whatever culture it is that those groups have lived for maybe thousands of years, and that is not up to we Westerners, we Americans, we imperialists, right, who think that we have all the answers. We don't get to go into other people's countries and tell them how to live their lives and how to practice their cultural beliefs. And when you say it like that, it's pretty powerful. That's a strong argument. We should not, and we have all sorts of sort of American guilt, right? It's almost the same thing as white guilt, but not quite, right? This idea that we Americans, we feel bad about being kind of jerks to the rest of the world, because we frequently are. And so when something like this comes up, we're like, oh yeah, right, no, sorry. We don't mean to tell you how to live. And so we sort of let it go. But, I mean, how do we feel about that? What's the other response? I mean, did that make sense, what I said? The idea of like the cultural defense of that sort of thing. Right? I mean, I was just basically given the relativist line by line response. I mean, it's not our culture, we don't get to have opinions about that. There, you know, it's right, they consider it right, so it is. We can't judge them. And so on. I mean, all of those sort of standard statements. Is that convincing?
No.
No? Is anybody convinced by that? It's okay. If you were like the one person convinced by that, you should say it's all right. Nobody's convinced by that. Why not? I mean, beyond the like logical, your tolerance can't be a universal. Why? I mean, it's not that. You're not upset by this thing because, we just learned about the logical impossibility of relativism. That's not the thing that is upsetting you. What is upsetting you? What's that?
Saying that
the
fact that Americans
will take
the land, that's okay, but
can't. Oh, sure. There's all sorts of hypocrisy involved in Americans suddenly becoming very, you know, sensitive to people's cultural stuff. But that's not, I don't think that's, I mean, that's anger in another group, right? I don't think people are upset with Americans here. I shouldn't say Americans, with the sort of normal culture. Because again, there are Americans there. Typically, because the typical process is to send, it's usually girls who have immigrated from other countries, and often they go back to that country for the procedure. And what makes it worse is often the place where those things happen are they're not appropriate services.
And the tools they're being used are not sterilized,
right,
either. It's just any piece of old metal.
It depends. It depends. It can be. It can be stuff like that. It can be shells. It can be sharp rocks. It can be glass. Sometimes it's actual surgical instruments, but often the circumstances are not what we would consider appropriate for surgery. There's often significant scarring, loss of life. Lots of people die But even if they don't die, they're usually pretty unhappy for the rest of their lives. And there's all sorts of mental PTSD, trauma issues involved. It's pretty horrible from an objective standpoint. And yet it happens a lot. Yeah.
What is the age that
It depends on the group. Usually it's right around puberty.
Puberty.
So we're talking teenage girls mostly. And again, I don't want to put my opinions on you, but it's horrible.
I think it's horrible.
It's terrible.
It's a horrible thing.
And there's probably nobody volunteering. Adult women are volunteering to say, hey.
No, not many. I mean, I don't want to say none, because certainly
some people in that culture probably are of that mindset because that's all they know.
Right.
They feel like it's their obligation or what have you, and so they submit to it. But if they had a choice and said, you know, they didn't have that.
Well, see, so that's part of the problem, and that's one of the things I want to bring up, right? We can all sit in this room and say, man, that is horrible. But many of the girls who undergo the process do so willingly. In fact, expect to have this done. And so how do you say to that person, no, you're wrong to feel that way?
Because they've been brainwashed with this type of...
But you can't say...
From a child.
But you say so brainwashed, and they're going to say, no, that's culture, in the same way that you've been brainwashed to wear shoes, right? To use Patrick's example.
Well, in my culture, where I came from, we wore bare feet, and I know I had to wear shoes, but that didn't feel comfortable under my feet.
Well, we could come up with another example, right? You've been brainwashed to think that shows with Ray Romano in them are funny, right? I mean, or whatever, right? There are any number of things that are part of this culture that you don't even think about. They just are the way they are. Do you drive on the right side of the road? You stop when the light turns red, right? These are things that you don't ever consider. You just do them because that's the way our culture is set up. But you wouldn't say you've been brainwashed to believe those things, right? They just are. So we have to be careful about the word brainwashed. Yeah.
I was going to say, if they're here in this country, maybe you could tell them they have options, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, sure. From a practical standpoint, right, education and so on, it seems like a good way to respond to it. But the question is, should we be responding to it?
If they inquire about it, or if they kind of make it seem like they want to...
Sure. But we don't ask, like, when children are abused, we don't ask them if they would like to not be abused. Right? We say, whoa, this is not good, and we're going to protect these children. And sometimes even taking them away from their parents whom they love, right, for their own good. So is that what we should be doing for these girls? Or should we be saying, you know, this is their decision, and this is their culture?
No, we should respect them, and we should talk about it. And
should we?
I think we should talk about it.
No, should we respect it? That's my question.
We should respect them and their culture. But
why?
That's their culture. Well, I mean, that's what they're used to in their life. But
I'm
here,
used to eating Big Macs every day, but it's not a good idea.
Yeah, so
but you do it.
By them being here, then, like, if right, we know about it going on there, then...
I'm just pointing out it's complicated. Right?
Yeah, it is.
It is. It's not... It seems really easy. Like, I said, female genital mutilation, everybody's face went... Right? And no, that's not a thing that should happen. But then when you start to think about it, it's more complicated. Crystal?
I think an issue that everyone has is the idea that it's mutilation. I'm wondering if...
Which is why they don't call it that, right? They call it circumcision.
Well, I'm wondering if it would be different if it was under a safe, sterile procedure. Would that change the way people looked at it? I think it's the idea that you're using instruments that aren't safe. People are losing their lives when they may not have to if you do it in a better environment. And I'm saying that because if some of them are choosing to,
so
that kind of makes me feel like...
Yeah.
Tracy
was shaking his head. What? Why?
No, I don't know why I was shaking my head. No, it's just you were saying that would that be make it better, and I don't think it would.
Not better.
Or more acceptable.
It's less... I don't think it's acceptable at all, but he's saying, like,
should we even step in? And I think that kind of like the idea of soft universalism, is that it's not safe. It's not safe for the girls. It's not, even if they choose it because they don't know no better or whatever, it's not safe. If they chose it, but it was safe for them, then it's a different, like, it's like, okay, that's what you want
to
do.
So you're sort of seeking a middle ground where you're not trying to prevent it from happening, but you're going to provide more appropriate safety.
Education.
Okay. Chelsea.
I'm, like, just wondering what good.
That's a good question. Although you could certainly ask the same question about male servitude, right? That, which has absolutely no medical benefit at all. Female circumcision is actually a little bit worse because not only does it have no actual medical benefit, it can usually—I mean, the majority of the time—it actually has negative consequences beyond even just the poor.
Environment.
Sure. That's not the word I was looking for, but close enough. Tools and so on, right? It often leaves the girls unable to, you know, to perform general bathroom activities correctly, or to certainly often unable to enjoy sex at all. And some women find it to be painful and unpleasant, and in fact, and plus there's often the pain of the sort of circumstance, which could be modified, right? We could make it so that it, you know, attach appropriate anesthesia so it's not as painful. But that there are lots of mental issues that come along with it. So there doesn't seem to be any positive, and there's a lot of negative, at least with the way it's done now.
A coworker and I had the same discussion. In our culture, my culture, and most cultures, we do circumcise babies. But in her culture,
boy babies. Yeah.
In her culture, she's like, no, we don't. She had just had a baby. I'm like, what? You didn't do it? And she's like, well, no, that's, we don't do that in my culture. I'm like, she's like, why did you do it? And I'm like, because I think that was just, you know, what we do.
You're
like,
brainwashed.
But they ask you.
But the I think Myrna's point is that a lot of people just say yes without thinking about watching.
If you ask, why do you? Many people don't know why they're having their boy baby. They said, well, that's what we do, right?
But it helps them.
Why do you drive on the right side of the road? Stop at red lights instead of blue, right? Because that's what we do.
I was going to say that's like giving the babies vaccines.
Ooh. Because there's science there, right? It's not 100%, but like, disease, vaccine, disease, right? That's a pretty clear indicator. That's not just like, well, we just give vaccines. I don't know why we do it.
There's science on both sides.
Yeah,
Now, actually, if you look at that's been pretty thoroughly debunked.
Maybe we should talk about
the connection. Well, we don't have to talk about that right now, but okay. I feel like it's worth pointing out that the science is pretty friendly in the same way that like the climate change is. Sure, you can find a guy who will say, oh, I'm a scientist and climate change is silly, but 97% of scientists agree that climate change is caused by people, right? More than that percentage of scientists believe that vaccines do not cause autism and are responsible for the massive decline in disease in the developed world. So I feel like I have to say that because relativism, right? Some people are just wrong. It's okay to say that,
but
right?
You don't have the right to not allow the person who's saying that.
You can say it.
You can say that they're wrong, but you have to give them an opportunity to tell you why did they feel that they're.
Yeah.
Sure, and then you get to tell them. I mean, you get to tell them that. But here's why that's not convincing, right? Like you can say vaccines cause autism, and I can say, well, actually, no, they don't, and here's why, right? And we can have that conversation. And I don't have to say, well, yeah, no, that's a good point. You found 1% of 1% of scientists who think that vaccines cause autism, and I guess I'll never be able to argue with that. I've got 98% of scientists over here. That's an argument you're allowed to say I win, right? Like, that's kind of my point. I'm not saying that I'm winning this argument. What I am saying, what I am saying is that not every opinion is equally right. Right? That not every, not my racist grandma wasn't right. Right? She was wrong, and I'm allowed to say that. You know, like it's not, and it's not just because, like, well, I'm alive and she's dead, and that's why I get to say it, right? I get to say that because she is, and I can prove it. I can go through that. I can do the math and explain to her, if she were here, why she's wrong. Right? And so,
no, because
it's an interesting question. It's an interesting question. I'd like to think so. I'd like to think that people are capable of listening. I mean,
like
probably not, right?
Two, it's also environment. You're absolutely right, but in the case
about
of grandma,
you don't have to say that. We'll just
no, because I agree with you.
Yes,
but in terms of race, but racism. But your grandma would have said, in the time she came up, it was totally right, and she may have been totally convinced about that.
But and this is
and I, again,
yeah, no,
and
I'm saying, right, this is good because it's all going back to the relativist thing, right?
Exactly.
That
exactly.
She was still wrong, right? The slave owners were still wrong. They can say as much as they want. I mean, they can't anymore because they're all dead. But they could have said that, like, this was just a function of our time and our culture and so on. That doesn't mean that owning people is ever right, right? That's just what it is. And you're allowed to say that's wrong. Cutting peasants in half with a sword is wrong. And that's okay. Right, we get to do that now because we are going to be able to say, and here's why.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and when you can do that, then the world is your playground. Right, you get to win at lots of cool things. You just got to be able to say, and here's why. And that's what this class is about. It's what all these philosophy classes are about: figuring out how to say, and here's why, rather than just Trump's a loony and then walking out of the room. Might be right, but you can't say why. It doesn't help. Yes? All right, I'm gonna let you guys go. Because I'm right now. homework, just so everybody's clear. I am gonna let you go, I promise. But I just wanna make sure everybody knows what they're doing.
You did not take attendance.
I totally took attendance.
You did?
Remember when I got your name right?
Oh,
that was a
I
noticed everybody. I think everybody is actually here, so
nope.
That makes it easy.
No, you're missing one.
Who are you missing?
You're missing
the veteran.
She dropped.
Oh, she did?
Yeah. I know. I was sad too.
What are we talking about outside?
So, for distance learning people, there will be here lecture videos of this lecture and a question for you to answer. Think that's weird. So you guys are reading Benedict's article, The Defense of Moral Relativism, and responding to it by Sunday night, just like you did last week.
I have a question, even though you'll never...
Is it about this?
Yes.
Okay, is it about this particular part of this?
Yes.
Go.
My question is, our online class is Monday, correct?
Because
we're in class on Wednesday.
Yes.
Why can't the assignment due for Monday?
For a couple reasons.
Yes.
One, I try to space it out as much as possible so that you have as much time between that assignment and the next one as you have between now and the first assignment. So I'm trying to kind of help you to spread your week out. I can usually grade it and look at it by Monday, and I need to have it in front of me to do it. I don't really have a chance between Monday night and Tuesday to look at it and give you guys some response.
So if it's submitted Monday morning, would that be considered late?
Yeah. I mean, it tells me how late you submit it, if you submit it late. If it's within a little while, I usually let it go. If it's more than a couple hours late, I usually mark it late. There's no hard and fast, like,
or, you know,
2 hours and 59 minutes is, like, not late. It's generally, if it's more than a couple hours late, it's late. Okay. So that's due Sunday night.
150 words.
100 is fine. 100 words. For Benedict's relativism. Reading James Rachel's response, and then writing this Rachel's essay. This is a paper, so it's 750 words. minimum. And the question is there that still, what's that?
She struggled with the 500.
No, it's going to depend on the topic. Some of them are going to be easier than others. There's a reason why I made the other one shorter.
Yeah,
this will be plenty long.
You'll just,
okay.
Yeah.
I know,
I tried
so
like
hard not
to.
Yeah,
and I did
it
so much.
Circles. It's all about circles. So this is again due Wednesday, just before class. Okay. Yes? I mean, I'm hearing you guys and your complaints. I'm just.
I just don't care.
What?
I think you enjoy it.
No, I'm not that much unsure. I don't enjoy your pain. I simply am willing to accept it. Have a good week. I will see you next week. Again, if you have any questions, if things are confusing, email me. Get in touch with me so we can figure it out, okay?